Hello and welcome to the September edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. I'm Dan Gallagher. Earlier this month, the Diocese of Scranton officially kicked off the 2019 Diocesan Annual Appeal. The theme for this year's campaign is Serving in Faith with Hope and Gratitude. In our opening segment today, we'll see how your ongoing support of the appeal is helping thousands of people across our diocese. Joining me now to discuss the campaign in greater detail, it's a pleasure to welcome Jim Bebla, Diocesan Secretary for Development. Jim, first question. I know we ask this every year, but I don't think people fully appreciate the scope of how the appeal benefits people in our diocese. Tell me a little bit about the appeal and how this funding really does help the Church of Scranton carry on its mission.
Gifts to the appeal are a blessing to so many in throughout our diocese. Appeal gifts support seminary and education, and that's the future of our church. It supports retired and ill clergy who have served our parishes and our diocese so very well throughout many years. All that the offerings of the parish life office that supports faith formation programs in the parishes, things like pre-marriage counseling, RCIA programs, all of our religious education programs in parishes. It supports parish social justice grants. Any parish can apply for a social justice grant for a program that might be running at their parish level as a food pantry, for example, or a dinner for folks in their area. So it reaches every corner of the diocese. It supports what we're doing right here, this program, and all that Catholic television does. The mass that's offered daily to people that are not able to get to mass. That's a real important feature. It also supports all of our Catholic schools. So everything that the diocese has and everything that happens in the parishes is supported by the appeal.
Jim, over the last several months, I know that you and Bishop Bambara had the opportunity to sit down and talk with a number of our priests and other people from parishes across the diocese. How did those talks really translate into changes in the appeal and how we're allocating funds?
Dan, we had wonderful conversations with our priests, with our appeal parish reps, with folks that have participated as donors in the past. And from those discussions, we have made some changes to the appeal. One of the big things that is new this year is we increased the allocation for Catholic social services. Catholic social services serve so many people. In fact, they serve over 300,000 people throughout the year in our kitchens, in our shelters, in our food pantries, all kinds of different services for counseling and helping people that are struggling a bit and that need a little hand to help them in the future. Veterans, for example, is also a big piece of what Catholic social services does. So the bishop has decided to increase that allocation. We have a new allocation for parish faith formation programs. We offer direct support to parishes for social justice grants that I just mentioned. Now we'll also have some money available that can be used for parishes for faith formation programs, for religious education programs, for example, or other things that parishes might be doing in their local communities. In addition, we've made some changes to the video. Typically, we produce one video. This year, we've decided to produce six versions of the video, a version for each of the regions. So in each region, we are highlighting things that the appeal supports, the gifts of the appeal support in the particular region. For example, we mentioned parish social justice grants. In Wayne and Pike County, we featured a parish social justice grant program that St. Anne's in Chihuahua is offering called Lorenzo's Lunch. In the Williamsport area, it was a food pantry, a clothing pantry at St. Joseph the Worker. At St. John Bosco, it was work that they're doing with the Salvation Army. They're providing a lunch once a month. They prepare and serve a lunch once a month. So those programs are being funded by the appeal, and we're talking about those in different regions. Catholic school students. In each region, we're featuring Catholic school students in a particular region. We're featuring retired priests. That's something that's very important to the appeal, that we care for our retired priests. They've served us so well, and they need our help in caring for them. So we featured different priests in different regions. Monsignor McGough, for example, in the Williamsport area. Monsignor Bendig in Luzerne County. Everybody knows Monsignor Bendig. Monsignor Feldkamp. in Wayne and Pike. So those are the types of things we did, different faith formation programs in the regions. We're also giving people the opportunity this year to designate their gift to a specific ministry. So if you're interested in supporting something specific, Catholic Social Services, for example, when you give your gift, you have the opportunity to designate your gift to Catholic Social Services. Or you can let us know that you want to use it where it's needed most. So I think those changes will be well received as things that people have been asking for. And so we're happy to be able to respond to those needs.
I mentioned earlier that we kicked off the campaign earlier this month. Looking ahead to the next several weeks and next several months, what are some of the significant weekends that will be taking place?
So the kickoff, as you said, happened the first week in September, and depending on the parish, it may have happened one week or another in September. The next big thing on the schedule is the Appeal Commitment Weekend, which is scheduled for October 5th and 6th. That's an opportunity for everybody in every parish to consider a gift to the appeal. And so our pastors, our parish reps, will be inviting people at Mass to make a gift to the appeal. And this year we're actually sending NPU Commitment Weekend envelopes prior to the Commitment Weekend so that people can take a look at what the appeal supports and prayerfully and thoughtfully consider their gift and be ready to make a commitment on that weekend. And of course, you know, we're looking for gifts of any amount, whatever people feel they can give. We certainly are appreciative of that. And we're so thankful to all of the donors that have supported us for many years. We have donors, Dan, that have been supporting the appeal every year for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. And it's so important to continue the mission of the diocese and all that we do in our diocese and in our parishes.
Over that opening weekend in October, in addition to collecting pledges, you'll also be collecting petitions?
Yes, for the last 2 years during the appeal weekend, we offer the opportunity for parishioners to add their prayer intentions. And they can do that. They don't have to make a gift in order to make a prayer intention. So if they make a prayer intention, those prayers will be remembered at a Mass that Bishop Bambera is going to have at the Cathedral, a Mass of Thanksgiving for appeal supporters on November 17th, Sunday, November 17th at the 10 o'clock Mass.
Now, for people that are watching this interview today, they want to find out more information about the appeal and also how they can support it. What resources are available?
So if you're interested in supporting the appeal, you certainly can contact the development office at the diocese. The other way to make a contribution is to go to our website, and that's annualappeal.org. Or they can go to the diocesan website, and on the tabs that say giving, if they click that tab, they can come right to the annual appeal website and they can make a gift online.
One last question. As you reflect back on the last several years that you have been working for the diocese and the response you have gotten from faithful across the 11 counties, how blessed and grateful are you to the people in this diocese who continually come out to support the appeal?
Dan, I feel incredibly blessed to be doing this work of fundraising ministry and to be working with so many people, so many like-minded people that are supportive of the mission and supportive of their parishes. We couldn't do this without the support of our parishioners, and we are so grateful. And on behalf of the bishop, I just want to extend my gratitude and my thanks for past support and for their consideration of a gift this year.
In a recent letter to the people of God, Pope Francis called upon the Catholic community worldwide to acknowledge past sins and mistakes with a penitential openness. In response to the Holy Father's invitation, the Diocese of Scranton observed a time of atonement and healing over the weekend of September 14th through the 15th, which included a Mass celebrated here at the Cathedral of St. Peter.
A year ago today, on the Feast of Our Lady of Sorrows, we gathered in prayer, just as we do today. At that time, I also led this local church in prayer for healing, for God's mercy, and forgiveness. Last year, this Mass took place 1 month after the release of the 40th statewide grand jury investigating sexual abuse by members of the clergy and its cover-up by church leaders. During that Mass, I acknowledged on behalf of so many of our good and faithful people, our religious, our clergy, that our diocese was enveloped in what was and continues to be one of its darkest moments in the history of the Church, and certainly in our 150-year history as a diocese. It's a year later. I can share with you a lot of things. I can stand before you and tell you that we've done much to change our attitude and to create a safer place in the Church, especially for young people. I can tell you that we've trained over 30,000 staff and volunteers to keep environments safe, and most especially our children safe. We cooperate with law enforcement. We attempt to be as transparent and as open as we can be. And we've established a compensation fund to provide, in some small way, a response to survivors of abuse. Yet, 1 year later, for all that we have done, there is still pain. There's still pain. A year can't change a lifetime of suffering for some individuals who have been so badly hurt. Survivors of abuse continue to be burdened by the ramifications of such inhuman behavior on the part of those who should have been trustworthy. None of us will ever know the depth of pain that survivors endure. Yet in courageously sharing their pain, so many of them with whom I have been privileged to meet this past year have taught me a great lesson. They've taught me that if the Church is truly intent on creating safe environments for its children and for all of God's people, we, the Church, and especially its leaders, must never forget or allow time to numb the pain that was so willfully inflicted on innocent lives by those who postured themselves as God's representatives and ministers of His love and mercy. Indeed, an authentic recognition of the pain of that cross is the only thing that can and will truly prompt us to change and create a Church that is deserving people's trust. As bishop of this local church, I deeply apologize for the pain that has been inflicted upon far too many of you by the leaders of our church. Once again, I ask for forgiveness from countless numbers of you who have suffered far too much. I pledge to continue to do all within my power to create a safe place for our children and for all people to worship, to pray, to learn, and to grow in faith. And I pray that we will all find hope in the wonderful words of St. Paul in his second letter to the church at Corinth that was proclaimed just a moment ago. He speaks to us of the treasure of faith. We hold this treasure in earthen vessels, fragile, broken vessels, our lives. We hold this treasure in earthen vessels that the surpassing power may be of God and not from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not constrained, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested within us. May we pray for the courage to once again walk together in faith, to renew the Church of Christ, to reflect his life, and to live in his love in a world that is so desperately in need of it. Our Lady of Sorrows, pray for us.
On Sunday, September 1st, hundreds of faithful gathered here at the Cathedral of St. Peter to take part in the annual celebration of the Mass in Italian. In his homily, Bishop Mambera reminded us that as we confront the challenge of new immigrants coming into our country, every soul has value and deserves to be treated with dignity, for it is created in the image and likeness of God.
La grazia del Signore nostro Gesù Cristo, l'amore di Dio Padre e la comunione dello Spirito Santo sia con tutti voi.
E con il tuo spirito.
Fratelli, per celebrare degnamente i santi misteri, riconosciamo i nostri peccati.
Prima lettura dal libro del Saracide. Figlio della tua attività, sei modesto. Sarai amato dall'uomo gradito a Dio.
Life and society places all kinds of obstacles in our paths that sometimes challenge us in a very, very difficult way in living out the gospel as fully as we believe that we should. But for as complicated as life can be, we still have the power to live the gospel. That same generous gospel that calls us in humility to give back to God generously in a day and in an age that so desperately needs that example, and yet at the same time challenges us in living it out. Let's keep this gospel in mind, brothers and sisters, as our nation confronts the challenge of new immigrants coming to our land. For as politicized as this issue can become from all sides, recall what's at the heart of today's gospel passage. One very simple lesson. Had nothing to do with being Democrats or Republicans or anything like that. It's rooted in the gospel of Jesus, that every soul has value and worth and deserves to be treated with dignity, because every soul is created in the image and likeness of God. Every soul deserves to be treated with respect. And I know that motivates us all this day. And you know what that means? It means that every parent, a second and a third generation American, and a new immigrant who's coming to this land is entitled to seek and provide for the well-being of their children. That means that every child has the right to experience the love and support of a parent. And that means that no immigrant, no person, in light of the most recent tragedy of this weekend, should ever fear for his or her life when they're in a shopping center, a movie, walking on the street, or praying in a house of worship. But we know that this past year in particular offers us some sad lessons that that's not always the case. While some of us may argue that these days are different than they were when our grandparents or great-grandparents came to this land, and they are to a certain degree, our parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents saw life differently when they opened the door to the poor and welcomed them to their tables to share from the little that they had. They respected every life, even if it was different than their own, and they welcomed every life, despite the fact that in some instances they themselves may not have been. Why? Because they were humble enough to see that their success didn't simply result from their own efforts, but in some way was due to the hand of God at work in them, blessing them in countless ways. That's what sets that generation apart. They gave God space in their lives far more than we do sometimes today. Pope Francis put it best. What is God's plan? It is to make of us all a single family of his children, in which every person, young and old, new immigrants, the poor, the marginalized, feels that God is close and feels loved by God. The church, he goes on, is born from God's wish to call all people to friendship with him. So God impels us to come out of our individualism and from our tendency to close into ourselves. And he calls us as brothers and sisters to participate in his one great family.
A lot of gratitude to Father Capelloni, of course, our chaplain emeritus, Monsignor Sicanolfi, and the wonderful choir led by Joseph Moffat. I owe you a lot of gratitude. Thank you. And we also owe a lot of gratitude to two individuals who have clearly been behind the scenes for, I think, decades now, and who have served this community very, very well, one of which is retiring very, very soon, and that's our controller in the city of Scranton here, Roseanne Novembrino. And Roseanne, we have a nice presentation for you, which you can remember, La Festa Italiana, for you know generations to come. And the other one, as Bishop Bambara was saying so appropriately in his homily, this is a different world, and there's so much that goes behind the scenes to make sure that there's peace and harmony in this community, and no one does a better job than that than the chief of police here in the city of Scranton, and that's Chief Carl Graziano. And Carl, this is for you. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Roseanne.
Il Signore sia con voi.
e con il tuo spirito.
Vi benedica Dio onnipotente, Padre e Figlio e lo Dio Spirito Santo. Amen.
After several years of planning, the Church of St. Gregory in Clark's Green officially dedicated a multi-million dollar expansion project on September 3rd. During a mass of thanksgiving, Bishop Bambera praised the parish community for its witness of faith and willingness to carry on Christ's mission of love and service.
What an incredibly glorious day this is, to give thanks to God in a space so familiar to you all. I will say, if you didn't get a peek behind those doors, I actually did. It's even better than you can imagine. It's really splendid. And what a great, great day this is for all of us, to give thanks to God for all the good things that God has and continues to do in our lives. This beautiful worship space has been home to some of you, I know, for over 40 years. And along with your new ministry center, this space and that new space as well are tributes to all of you in so many and different ways about how you have worked together to grow not merely a building complex, but far more importantly, who you are as the church, the people of God. Well, I could never begin to thank the countless numbers of parishioners, building professionals, neighbors, and friends who have helped to bring this day to pass. On behalf of all of you, I would like to recognize one person who has worked tirelessly to make this moment a reality, your pastor, Father John LaPera.
Last evening, at about 11 o'clock, I stood outside of this new center and our church in the dark and saw the lights on for the very first time. And it lit up and it glowed. So much so that people were driving down the driveway and circling to see what had happened on this dark campus. Then, one of the members of our steering committee pulled in to sneak a peek. He rolled down his window and he said to me, "Do you remember what was in the case statement? Our ministry center will be a beacon that calls the community to the inner life of the Spirit." So, my friends, let's move to the blessing of our new space. The acknowledgement of individuals responsible for leadership and execution of this project are all listed in your program. I dare not mention one name because we did this together, everyone. There are individuals who I can see in front of me who held me up and walked with me and made this possible. I will always be grateful. This parish is grateful for you, but tonight, this celebration is about all of us.
God of every blessing, through the incarnation of your Son, you created light from darkness. Through his death and resurrection, you created life from emptiness. By your Spirit of love, all things are created anew. Send your Spirit then upon this parish family, who today dedicates this ministry center to your service. that according to your will, they might also bring light and life to an often dark and empty world. Bless this space and make it holy. May it be for all who enter a sign of your love in the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In addition to serving as pastor of Our Lady of Mount Carmel Parish in Lake Silkworth, Father Alex Roach is also the chaplain here at Holy Redeemer High School in Wilkes-Barre. Now that our Catholic schools have started a new school year, Father takes a moment to reflect on the value of a Catholic education and how God's goodness is present in every academic discipline.
As we continue to roll through September, and students and teachers and professors at Catholic schools and public schools and colleges around our diocese really start to get into the swing of the school year, I'm brought back to a great opportunity I had last January when I was privileged to be able to travel to Tucson, Arizona to the Vatican Observatory's Faith and Astronomy Workshop. It was really an incredible chance to see, on the one hand, these Jesuit priests and brothers who are also world-renowned scientists, and on the other, astronomy professors from the University of Arizona and other places who were able to speak intelligently and eloquently about their faith and about our God. As strange as that might sound to us, in a lot of ways, that's more the norm throughout history than it is the exception. For most of human history, a truly educated person was not just a person who knew about their subject or knew the things that were going to make them the most money or help them in their career. An educated person was a person who was able to talk about a wide variety of things. Werner Heisenberg, the father of quantum physics, wrote a book about philosophy. Marie Curie took care of the children of a factory owner. Gregor Mendel, the founder of modern genetics, was a monk and a gardener. It wasn't just famous scientists, though. For centuries, a truly educated person was a person who was just as comfortable quoting Shakespeare as they were Copernicus, as they were St. Paul. What does that have to do with Catholic education? Well, I think in a sense that is Catholic education. Catholic, as we know, means universal. Catholic means that we recognize that truth has one source. Truth is unified. Truth doesn't contradict itself, so we should never be afraid of pursuing truth wherever we find it. We can discover truth in science, in philosophy, in mathematics or English. We can never discover truth in theology, in history. I think the reason for that is that as Catholics, we view the universe as sacramental. Of course, we know about the seven sacraments, those seven guaranteed and privileged visible signs of God's invisible grace. But the sacramental universe doesn't stop with those seven sacraments. In fact, the entire universe is pregnant with visible signs and symbols with markers and identifiers of God's goodness, of God's glory, and of God's presence. In reality, we should be comfortable seeing and experiencing God in an equation or an ecosystem or a poem. The beauty of our sacramental vision of the world lies in recognizing that since our world is understandable and knowable, since our world has signs and symbols for us to discover and explore, and that means that the God who created that world also wants to be understood and known. Today, as so many students and teachers and professors around the diocese begin their school year, as they dive into their studies, it's worth all of us remembering our Catholic education. Catholic education isn't a particular place or subject. A Catholic education means being open to explore and discover and experience the universe and to find all around us signs and symbols of our God's goodness and our God's truth.
Over the weekend of November 1st through the 3rd, the Diocesan Office for Parish Life will be conducting a weekend experience known as Rachel's Vineyard for anyone who has been touched by the trauma of abortion. In our next segment, we'll see how Rachel's Vineyard is providing individuals with a safe place to renew, rebuild, and redeem hearts that have been broken by abortion. Joining me now to discuss this retreat experience in greater detail, it's a pleasure to welcome Denise Menjak, who is the diocesan coordinator for the local Rachel Vineyard Retreat Weekends. Denise, thank you for being here. Denise, for the benefit of people who are watching this today who have no idea of what Rachel's Vineyard is about and the retreat experience, how would you describe it and the main premise of it?
The Rachel's Vineyard post-abortion healing retreats are a weekend opportunity to experience the depth of God's compassion for the wound that abortion imparts on an individual, on a family. It's an opportunity to get away from all of the pressures of life and take the time to really listen to what God is telling you in your heart. And we guide that process through such things as like living scripture exercises, in which we take a scripture story and we place ourselves within that. And at that point, the Holy Spirit takes over and begins to work within the wound. And the process is towards reconciliation with yourself, because everyone coming is feeling regret, remorse, pain, guilt. For many years, most people have suffered with this in silence. The goal is further reconciliation with God and then with their child. And when they're leaving the weekend, the contrast is they arrive feeling like, I killed my child, my child is dead. They leave knowing that their child is alive with Christ, and they leave with the forgiveness of their child, which is something only God can do.
Denise, when I think of Rachel's Vineyard, I often think of that old adage that time heals all wounds. And I think a lot of people that have been impacted by abortion probably think that if I give it enough time, it'll get better with the years that pass. But is that necessarily the case? Why should people who have been impacted by abortion take advantage of retreat experiences like Rachel's Vineyard?
Basically, because time does not heal the wounds. Most people that reach out for this opportunity, the experience has happened, I'd say, a minimum of 10 years ago. Could be 20, 30, 40 years ago. And actually, the pain, the silent suffering intensifies and becomes very personal, very private, which is something that is common with a traumatic loss, is that initially people may feel, oh, it's over, I want to pull myself together, get on with my life. And for a number of years, they're trying to put something behind them, but it does catch up.
I'm sure there are a lot of people out there that think Rachel's Vineyard is an experience for just the woman who has had an abortion. But when you think about it, there are so many other people that are impacted by the pain of abortion. Is the retreat experience open to others aside from just the woman who has had an abortion?
Definitely. It's open to mothers, fathers, grandparents, sisters, brothers, anyone who played a role in the abortion taking place, and it's open to the medical providers, people that have been a part of this industry. With Abby Johnson's The Movie Unplanned coming out, I think that's opened people's eyes, that medical providers are also deeply impacted by playing a role.
During the course of this retreat experience, people walk into a room with others who have gone through the pain of abortion. Why is there such power in moments like that when they can share with others who have been down that same path?
It's not a secret anymore, and their secret is being laid out gently with a compassionate crowd, with a crowd who can almost finish their sentences for them, who can relate to the pain and the shame and the guilt and the grief. And part of the beauty of it too is our members of our team have gone through the retreat for their own healing. So they're seeing people that are on the other side of this journey. And that gives them hope.
Denise, I'm sure a lot of people are somewhat reluctant to sign up for a retreat weekend, not knowing what to expect. Looking at a weekend, what exactly does transpire during Rachel's Vineyard?
And the first thing I want to say is it's a very casual atmosphere, very comfortable. We want people to dress comfortably, that we are the only people in the retreat house at that time, so there is privacy. I always greet people and acknowledging the courage it took to walk in, because that's probably the hardest thing, is to get out of the car and walk into the retreat center. We have people that are kind of waiting at the door just to encourage them and say, I know what this feels like, you don't have to be afraid, and helping to reduce some of their anxiety. But the retreat experience is not a forced encounter. It's an open invitation from Christ saying, I know you're suffering and I understand this wound. Just put your hand in mine and let's walk slowly through this process. Let's examine the wound and then let's have compassion for who you were at that time, understanding you through the eyes of God, not just through the critical eyes that they've been judging themselves with for these years, recognizing everything that was going on around them, their own weaknesses, where they were in life, and then evolving to a point where they're continually opening and asking God to restore them as the prodigal son. You know, I'm here, let's make all things new, let me grow from this. I now have something that I can share with others. I have experience, and maybe I can make a difference in someone else's life. But then there's also the Holy Spirit's revelation of who their child was, to know their child as a boy, as a girl, naming their child, and encountering that child through one of our exercises, and then honoring the life by formalizing the grief through a memorial service, and then a mass of entrustment, which is like a resurrection celebration.
Denise, I'd like to touch upon something you mentioned about the power of God's healing love. When you look at the Rachel's Vineyard retreat experience, is this also an opportunity not just to heal emotionally, but also spiritually?
I can say, based on the testimony of members of our team and other people that have gone through the weekend, that they do feel reconciled with God again, that they have an awareness that their child forgives them and that their child longs for them to reconcile with God. A lot of times I remind them of the Apostle Paul, who was Saul, who murdered Christians, who was a part of murder. And they're saying, you know, how could God ever forgive me? It's like, well, he chose someone who killed one of, Stephen was the first, you know, that he was involved in taking lives. And God's love is so far beyond our imperfections. Yeah.
From November 21st through the 23rd, a delegation from the Diocese of Scranton will be among some 23,000 young Catholics and adult chaperones that'll be taking part in the National Catholic Youth Conference in Indianapolis. As we're about to see in this next segment, this pilgrimage of faith offers young people amazing opportunities to encounter Christ, experience church, and be empowered for discipleship. Joining me now to discuss the conference, it's a pleasure to welcome Shannon Kowalski, who serves as our diocesan coordinator for youth and young adult ministry. Next, I'd like to welcome Kelly McConnell, who is director of youth ministry for St. Eulalia's Parish in Roaring Brook Township. Ladies, thank you so much for being here today. Shannon, both you and Kelly have been going to this conference now for several years. And I know when I talk with young people that are part of this experience, they always come back excited and fired up about their faith. What is it about the National Catholic Youth Conference that really seems to resonate with so many young Catholics?
I think because it's such a countercultural experience from what they're used to getting here at the diocese. It's not their typical religious education. It's not in their parish center or the church basement. You know, it's 30,000 students, chaperones coming together in an NFL football stadium to celebrate faith. But beyond that, I think it's just a good holistic program that really gives good bites of what it means to be Catholic in every sense of the word. But the crowd itself, I think, is the biggest shot in the arm to see that many people who are practicing Catholic. It's comforting, I think, to a lot of our students, and then they're able to go back and say, I was one of so many, and I'm going to be that person here back home too.
Kelly, I know earlier today you were telling me that this is probably the fourth year the fourth time you've been doing this. You've had a group from your parish that have been part of three of these conferences. Why do you think there is such value in taking them out of Roaring Brook Township and having them experience this pilgrimage on a national level?
It's really impactful to push them out of their comfort zone. They can kind of fall into the same patterns when they're at their home parish and we're at our home youth group. And we take away all that comfort and we put them in a whole new environment with new people and priests walking around and nuns walking around and getting to hear dynamic speakers to help them learn about their faith and really just encounter the church as a whole and learn about really the pillars of their faith and some of the traditions. It really does help push them out of their comfort zone and let them absorb some pieces of it. And the best part of that is they get to bring it back to the parish with them. So many of my youth have come back and have really clearly stated that this was one of the best experiences of their life, one of the most meaningful, most impactful, and it's so great then to be able to see them translate that experience into our home parish community.
Shannon, one of the things I've discussed with young people that have been part of this over the last few years, when they're here in the diocese, through some of the events we have, like ISLI and Light the Fire Youth Rally, they kind of experience church on a diocesan level, but here they have the opportunity to mingle and talk with young Catholics from just about every corner of the country, and you see them exchanging little mementos and buttons and whatnot. Why is that such a special part of what the National Catholic Youth Conference, the fact that young people here from Scranton can be talking with somebody from California or Florida or whatever the case may be?
I think just as Kelly said, we have this tendency to become isolated and only focus on our experience and our experience here in the local church. And that could kind of feel somewhat isolating that, you know, we're the only ones who do this or I'm the only one going through this. But it's really neat to see them make connections there's students from all of the 50 United States and the U.S. territory. So it's a really representative population that's at NCYC. So it's really neat to hear them say, oh, I made friends from Alaska, or, you know, did you know that people in California, you know, they do this, or they have this prayer experience. So it's really neat to see them just make friends, plain and simple, but to know that they have friends who can support them in a lot of the same questions or struggles or experiences of faith.
Kelly, quite often a young Catholic in our diocese, when you think about the challenges they face in our secular society today, they might not always feel comfortable going out into the community and boasting about being a Catholic, but here's a situation where they walk into this enormous stadium and look around at thousands of young Catholics who are excited and proud of the fact that they're Catholic. Is that really an empowering experience when they're with other young Catholics who are just proud to say, hey, listen, I'm Catholic, I love Jesus, and they know that there are so many others that share that same belief?
Absolutely. Going to NCYC really gives kids that feeling that they're not alone, and it connects them to the universal church. Then they can feel empowered to go back to their home parishes, go back to their schools, and find that sense of bravery that allows them to say, hey, I'm a proud Catholic, and here's some great things that I'm doing with my faith. It's really just the energy and the culture of NCYC that helps build these kids up and give them that confidence in their faith and in themselves to be able to go forth and spread that good news.
Shannon, for someone watching this interview today who has never been part of this conference, give me an idea of what does transpire over the course of those 3 days as far as the events that are taking place and the opportunities.
Sure. So it's a series of general sessions. So we come together in Lucas Oil Stadium, the home of the Indianapolis Colts, 30,000 people, to listen to one person give a keynote. So it's generally surrounding the theme of this year's NCYC. And in between that, there's a lot of different things to keep people engaged. New prayer experiences. We might pray a rosary, but pray it all together with 30,000 people. The Chaplet of Divine Mercy. So general session, keynote speaker, interactive experience, concerts. Oftentimes they bring in big bands, names that are borderline mainstream and borderline Christian that would be familiar to the students. And then in between general sessions, there's breakout sessions for workshops. And there's 50 or 60 different workshops to choose from at any given time. And they really do a good job of trying to diversify those workshops. Could be anything from youth, teen anxiety and depression to how do I go deeper in my faith? And there's workshops for adults too, which I really appreciate. How do you go deeper with your students? How do you disciple them? Other than that, there's an interactive park. It's really hard to describe the interactive park. It's kind of a collection of everything. It's like a giant college fair, but for Catholic ministries, which really draws the kids in. That's a good place for them to go and blow off some energy from sitting and listening to keynotes or sitting in workshops. It's where they get to do the one-on-one of the NCYC experience.
Kelly, what has been your own experience? Do you think young people from your own parish and from our diocese, and Catholics in general around the country, do you think young Catholics are looking for more opportunities to be more involved in the life and the mission of the church?
Oh, absolutely. I think going to a conference like NCYC really opens up so many opportunities for students and helps them see so many different venues that they do have. They get to explore vocations. They get to explore different types of prayer opportunities. And at NCYC, there's even service opportunities built into it. So not only is it a great thing for kids to do to go and have, you know, the experience of being there, but it also then is a platform for them to jump off to experience some other types of ministries and think about some other questions moving forward with their faith. So it's a great opportunity for kids all around.
Shannon, you mentioned that in addition to the workshops and the general sessions, obviously there are several opportunities for prayer and for a mass. When you experience liturgy there at the National Catholic Youth Conference, why do young people get so fired up and so excited about that?
I think simply put that the feeling of the Holy Spirit is so obvious. You know, it's palpable. And when you're anywhere with 30,000 people, that's a powerful experience, a sports game or whatever. But, you know, Mass is just on a whole other level. One of my favorite experiences from NCYC is just hearing everybody sing. Whether or not you're a singer, everybody sings, and that the music fills the stadium. and then after communion, which in itself is a feat to get 30,000 people communion, afterwards, everybody's quiet, they're silent, they're reverent, they're in a deep place of prayer, you can hear a pin drop, and it's just so peaceful and soulful that you could just feel that everybody is having an intimate encounter with Christ at that moment. It's very moving.
Kelly, it's great that they have this three-day experience, but if they just left it at the doorstep of the Lucas Stadium, it would mean nothing. Is it your hope that the fire and the excitement of that conference is something that these young people will bring back to their respective parishes and communities?
Absolutely. You know, we call those mountaintop moments where, you know, you're at a retreat or an experience like NCYC and you feel like you're on top of the world and you're untouchable. But then you have to leave and you have to go back to your home parish and your family life and your school life and figure out how that all translates. And the great part about it is that here in the diocese and in individual parishes throughout the diocese, we have so much great programs going on in youth ministry that there is a lot of things to help keep the excitement going. So when kids come back from NCYC, we want them to get involved in their local parishes. We want them to be involved in diocesan programming and retreats. And by helping continue that pattern of mountaintop moments, we hope that we can keep the energy going and really help to spread it throughout the diocese as well.
Shannon, for a young person that's watching this interview today and is now excited about the possibility of going to the National Catholic Youth Conference, how can they go about getting more information or possibly even how they can register?
Sure. So I would say first place to start is to contact their DRE, youth minister or pastor. They should have the information to get them in touch with the group that's going if they themselves can't form a parish delegation. Other than that, I'm always happy to answer any questions here at the diocese, and all of my information can be found on the diocesan website.
That's all the time we have for now. On behalf of the staff at Catholic Television, I'd like to thank you for joining us today and invite you to tune us in again next month for our next edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese.